7. And remember last week, chapter 46 was talking about Jacob moving and finally arriving. Jacob finally saw his son. He had not seen Joseph for such a long time. And now he is settled into the land of Goshen. It's a northern part near Canaan. So now chapter 47 will be the last about Jacob. He's close to death. So we'll see what happens in this chapter 47. We'll do one all the way through. We'll expound on some of the verses and how they apply to our lives. During the time of the Pharaoh, ruling only Egypt. Yes, he ruled Egypt. The first one says, then Joseph went to see the Pharaoh and told him, my father and my brothers have arrived from the land of Canaan. They have come with all their flocks, you know what that means, like sheep, chickens, well now maybe not birds so much, but sheep. They called them flocks. Like steers and cows and possessions, which are things. And now they are in the region of Goshen. The reason why Joseph told Pharaoh, why did Joseph feel like he had to tell Pharaoh that my family has arrived? In chapter 46. It's repeated here again in 47. So why did Joseph tell Pharaoh? Because he didn't want them to be, it was proper to tell Pharaoh what was happening to keep him informed. Don't want him to be clueless. Okay. So Joseph knew that it was proper to let him know that his family had arrived. So in verse 2, Joseph took 5 of his brothers with him and presented them to Pharaoh. Why would he do that? Joseph took 5 of his brothers, and why would he do that? It doesn't say. Some people believe that the 5 brothers were the oldest, not the youngest. They were more mature, more skilled to do other things, not only take care of animals, but how to fix fencing or something to that degree. I figured that it was the 5 oldest. Not for sure. What's interesting is that why did he pick the number 5? Why not all of them? Why not all of them? Why just 5? The oldest? Just to pick the oldest of the group? It's interesting. Remember before when we were studying chapter 43, it says that Joseph filled their plates with foods from their own table and given Benjamin. Remember, Benjamin was the youngest brother, and he had the same mother, Rachel, as Joseph. He gave him 5 times as much as he gave the other brothers. He gave Benjamin 5 times the food. So there's another scripture. Chapter 45, verse 22 says, that he gave each of the new clothes, you know, one set of clothes apiece. But Benjamin, they gave him five different sets of clothes. So the number five seems to be significant. Benjamin was the real brother. But no, my question isn't really, why are we focused in on the number five? People think that five was probably Egyptians' favorite number. Here, we always call it lucky number seven. And maybe for the Egyptian, it was five. You know, Joseph probably knew that five was their number. That's the reason why he used five. But that's what it appears, we're not for certain. But I'm not sure if the other five came. Verse 3 said, and Pharaoh asked the brothers, what is your occupation? Which means, what is your job? What do you do? Remember in chapter 46, Joseph told them, the father and the brothers, you tell the Pharaoh that you're shepherds. Why? He said, make sure you tell them that that was our occupation. They weren't slaves, but the Pharaoh could use them to become other things. And he didn't want that to happen. He wanted them to know, you know, my profession, or my job or occupation as a shepherd. So they replied, we, your servants, are shepherds, just like our ancestors, generations before. So if you notice here, it says, we, your servants, means that they're already slaves. No, they were just under the authority, humble. We are your servants. You know, Pharaoh was king, just like Jacob did to his brothers, Esau. Remember, they came back together, Jacob and Esau, they forgave each other. But Jacob says, I'm your servant, as a sign of honor and respect. This is the same. Showing honor. And it says that we have come to live here in Egypt for a while. You know, they say, but for a while. Do they plan to stay forever? No, that was not their plan. Just for a while. Why did they say just for a while? They were looking for a right place to place, or are you talking another place? They were going to go back to the promised land, or Canaan. You know, maybe when the famine stopped, they would move. Well, they knew that they had already got a promise from God saying, you will have land in Canaan. So you will go back. So they let them know that we've only come for a while. They knew that God had not led them to stay there permanently for years. The names of Israel started to be established. Now you're talking later into the future. We're not talking about it. Says, we'll stay for a while here, for there is no pasture, which means grass. You know, it's dry, there's a famine, there's nothing going, nothing growing. And it would happen for 7 years. So 5 years. Yeah. famine is very severe there. So please, we request or are asking. Asking the Pharaoh to give them permission to live in the region of Goshen. Remember, he had already been, Joseph had already let them know that they could settle in Goshen. And the Jewish people or the Hebrew people had moved to the land of Goshen. Why are they asking now for permission? Why? They were wanting to be white and proper. They knew that Joseph had said for them to settle there, but they were requesting to stay because the Pharaoh had ultimate authority. Are we allowed to stay in Goshen for a while? No, we're not wanting to be permanent, just for a short time, if you will give us permission to stay. Before maybe Pharaoh thought they would stay there for many, many years. Said no, just they were asking just for permission to stay for a short time. I wonder if Canaan was a large area. It was a country. It's not a town, it was a country. There was different nations in the land. To stay in Goshen. You know, there's pasture there, there's plenty. Animals to graze, right? That was the question you were asking. It was already there because it was near the Nile River. It's a big river. So you can imagine the water that flowed through there might have dried out. But the land was swampy. Now it was still had water in it and it was growing. So it was near the Nile River. Remember Joseph had a dream that warned about famine? And the dream was this. It says, in his dream he saw seven fat, healthy cows come up out of the river and begin grazing in the marsh. It's kind of like a swamp, but it still has vegetation that grows, grass that grows. And then he saw seven more cows come up from behind them from the Nile. But these were scrawny, thin, and these cows stood beside the fat cows on the riverbank. That's the land near the riverbank. So the water was plenty for grazing. For Jacob's family, there was already water there from the Nile. So now that your father and your brothers have joined you here, choose any place in the entire land of Egypt for them to live. There's plenty of land in Goshen. You could pick whatever you wanted. Give them the best land of Egypt and let them live in the region of Goshen. And if any of them, we'll hold on to that thought. So recently the Pharaoh said, go ahead, choose any land. There's other Bible translation like the ESV, the KJV, just very translations. You'll notice in the verse, 47 verse 6, it says the land of Egypt is before you. Meaning, you can take whatever you want. Pick. It's all yours. The next translation says the land of Egypt is open before you. Meaning, go ahead and choose whatever you want. Yeah, there's different translations. The land of Egypt is at your disposal, and the land of Egypt is theirs. And at your disposal. Meaning your use of whatever you want. Whatever you want. Whatever you want to choose, you take it. It's at your disposal. You decide. And then the land of Egypt is theirs. So now it goes back and says if any of them have special skills. Remember, this is the Pharaoh talking. Put them in charge of my livestock. Egyptians, remember, they didn't really like shepherds. You know, it's been their culture, their perspective. And do you remember why they didn't like the shepherds? Because they were dirty. They were lower class. Well, you remember before, the Egyptian people had a bad tragedy. You know, people from other countries coming in, the barbarians, those who were considered nomads or travelers, those that didn't stay in any one spot, set up housing. But nomads, they were like shepherds. When they came into Egypt, they pillaged. So that was very tragic for them. So they remembered that from in their past. So they called that barbarians. So they did not like shepherds. But they had livestock, cattle. It was very important for them to have that. They had to have that for working, for plowing, for building. Yes, they used animals. So if you have the skills to take care of animals, well then come on and you can take care of my animals or my livestock. Number 7 says, then Joseph brought in his father Jacob and presented him to the Pharaoh. And Jacob blessed Pharaoh. Meaning what? And Jacob blessed the Pharaohs. Blessed the Pharaoh with it. Jacob knew that God chose Jacob, the one who would have descendants and make him a great nation. God had already chose Abraham, who followed God. Then came the son Isaac. Then came Jacob. And in the New Testament, Jesus names Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Remember? God? Yeah, just those three. And God gave Jacob the name of what? Israel. So Israel would be the father of a great nation. And God had chosen his people, Israel, to come out of the lineage of Hebrews or Jewish people. So the Messiah, Jesus, would be born from that lineage. And Jacob knew that God had given him the authority to bless. So he could, God blessed the Pharaoh. Jacob was not ashamed of his belief in one God. Egyptians had a lot of gods, idols, and Jacob did not believe in them, but he was bold. He says, I will bless you, and God will bless you, because the Pharaoh had given so much and invited them in to stay. Let them have a good life. So Jacob wanted to bless the Pharaoh. Jacob is not looking at the Pharaoh as being scared of him. No. He came to him as blessing him because he knew that God was the ultimate authority. He was not ashamed of what he believed. He wanted to give a blessing that would be from God. Jacob wasn't scared of Pharaoh. He knew that God was sovereign. Just like we need to stand for what we believe. Stand strong in our faith, not be embarrassed of our faith in Jesus. Because God is simply the ultimate King of Kings. Our talk, our behavior should show our faith. We should be strong in our faith. We know that there is one God. There is none like it. Hebrews 7:7 was talking about Jacob, you know, trusting in God being supreme. And in Hebrews 7:7 it says, and without any question, the person who has the power to give a blessing is greater than the one who is blessed. So that person who blesses has power, is greater than the one or the person who is receiving the blessing. So the one who blesses is the one who's greater. So Jacob is greater than the Pharaoh. This actual verse is talking about Melchizedek and Abraham. And he was a king and a priest. there's not much information about him. You know, there's not a lot about him in the Old Testament, but he blesses Abraham. He's a king of... Now Jacob replied, I have traveled this earth for 130 hard years. Why did he say that? His life for 130 years. So you remember, he deceived his father Isaac, and it made his brother angry, Esau. He wanted to kill him. So the mother had heard and sent Jacob away. So the father Isaac had blessed him and sent him. He would not see his mother again. And Jacob became the shepherd. He went to his uncle Laban, and then he married, and he didn't see his parents. And then Laban, his uncle, deceived him, you know, wanting to marry his daughter, worked for 7 years. He thought he was going to marry Rachel, slept with the woman he thought to be Rachel, but it was Leah. And then Laban said, 7 more years, you can have Rachel. Yeah. Went ahead and married Rachel, but had to work for 7 years. Laban wanted him to stay, and Laban chased him. And then finally, Laban let him go. Blessed the children and let him go. So it's Jacob's family, you know, had a lot of family that traveled, met Esau, remember he wrestled with God, and then God dislocated his hip and gave him the name Israel. So, you know, he had a very hard life. He went through a lot of things, but he also traveled. He wasn't very settled. So it says, maybe some of you feel, you know, frustrated, you know, hard years. Maybe you've gone through some terrible suffering. You know, just different things that it could have happened. But you know that God is with you. Just like Jacob, he went through a lot of difficult times. But he still knew that God was with him. And it's important that we remember. Is the Christian life, once we're saved, easy and perfect? No problems? No. We have problems that occur, show up. We suffer for our faith. Some may persecute you. It's a hard life. Maybe family members are against you. But you know that God is with you. If you have problems with your family, friends, your job, things might get messed up, doesn't mean that God's ignoring you or deserting you. Never. Because God will not ever ignore us because of what Christ has done. He cherishes us. He loves us as his children. So whatever problems come up, our hard life that we experience does not mean that God has rejected us. He's still faithful. We go through our suffering and trust that God is with us, just like Jacob. He has a hard life. But my life has been short compared. compared to the lives of my ancestors. And then Jacob blessed Pharaoh again before leaving his court. So it says, my life has been short, which is true. Jacob was there in Egypt for 17 years, and he died. How old? 147. How old was Abraham? 175, Isaac 180, and Jacob 147. He knew that his life was finished, not like his father or his grandfather. Why? Because of the stress. Things that he went through. He just kept bearing through. To his father and his brothers, and he settled them there, just as the Pharaoh had commanded. And Joseph provided food for his father and his brothers, appropriate amounts to the numbers of their dependents. Children, just the right amount, including the smallest children. Meaning that Joseph made sure that all of the families had enough to eat. Like maybe there might be a family that had five, maybe another family had 10. He gave them enough for the five, and he would give more to those that are the 10, so that they would have more. They would not grow hungry. They would have enough for each of their families, and they would be satisfied. Just like us, we want to make sure we have enough to eat. Breakfast, lunch, have enough. Not sparse, and you get hungry. Joseph did not want that to happen to him. So it shows that Joseph was so kind to take care of everyone, to make sure they had been well fed, just like Christ. When we trust in Jesus for our salvation, he provides us with plenty. Prayer prepares a room for us, gives us the Holy Spirit, gives us eternal life. We're satisfied. So Joseph gave everything out that the king had given. Pharaoh didn't tell him to limit it. No. He said, why? Because Joseph was the one who interpreted the dream, which saved the people of Egypt. If it was not for Joseph being there, many of them would have died. So the Pharaoh was very grateful to Joseph and gave him whatever he needed. Land, food, whatever it was. Just like God the Father gives us what we need because Jesus has paid our debt. And he's given us blessing. We did nothing to deserve it. Joseph had provided for his family. So meanwhile, the famine became so severe, it worsened, that all the food was used up. And the people were starving throughout the lands of Egypt. All the other countries. So it was so severe that selling grain, such as corn, to the people, Joseph eventually collected all the money from Egypt and Cana, and he put the money in the Pharaoh's treasury. One of the lifeboats, trying to pay the man to get in the boat, maybe. And the man threw the money to the side. Why? Because the money was not going to do anything. He wouldn't be able to use it. Once the boat sank, it would be gone. It's the same idea. You know, people think, oh, I have riches, I'll be fine. You know, I can buy whatever I need. Can you buy your salvation? The only one who could have purchased our salvation is Jesus. He's our Redeemer. He saves us. Only he can pay our debt. Same idea. How do we pay? How do we do? So Joseph replied, since your money is gone, bring me your livestock, and I will give you food in exchange for your livestock. So they brought their animals, their livestock, to Joseph in exchange for food, in exchange for their horses, their flocks of sheep and goats, herds of cattle, donkeys. Joseph provided them food for another year. So what do you think? that's the reason why they became slaves, because they gave everything away. And they're a long time ago. And then to New America. They didn't have money. So they helped and bartered. So verse 18 said that if a year ended, and the next year they came again and said, "We cannot hide the trees from you, my Lord. Our money is gone and all of our livestock. And the cattle are yours. We have nothing left to give but our bodies and our land." Joseph accepted for them to become slaves. "We offer our land ourselves as slaves for Pharaoh. Just give us grain so that we may live and not die, and so the land does not become empty and desolate." Means without nothing. Joseph bought all of the land of Egypt for Pharaoh. All of the Egyptians sold out their fields. And the famine was so severe, and soon all the land belonged to Pharaoh. Joseph was kind. He accepted. And then they became slaves. As for the people, he made them all slaves. From one end of Egypt to the other. So why? So we're talking about slaves. It means like long ago, time ago here, you know. Around the Civil War, you know, we had slaves. It was horrible. Is this what we're talking about? No. Joseph, you know, they didn't whip slaves, use and abuse them. No. It just meant you'll come in and do service. But it provided food for them. It took care of them. They didn't have to worry. The land was safe. It wouldn't become worse and desolate. And later, going forward, you will see how Joseph is kind. Wasn't like he was trying to take power, that he had all of this and now they were under him. No. The verse 22 says, "And the only land he did not buy was what belonged to the priests." But not really priests. It was talking about the Egyptian priests. They're religious. You know, they worship false gods. Didn't buy their land because the priests, they received food from the Pharaoh. There was no point for them to sell the land. They already had food. Same as Israel, Jacob's people, they had food. So, and they received part of the scripture says they received food from the Pharaoh, and they didn't need to sell their land. And it says, then Joseph said to the people, look, today I have bought you and your land for Pharaoh. I will provide you with seed so you can plant the field. Joseph wasn't, doing away with them and keeping all the land and not taking care of them. No, he gave them the land. You can go ahead and work the land. Kind of like renting. But with the understanding that you were given seed and that you would have to plant. The famine is close to the end, knowing that they would be able to grow food in their crops and they would have plenty of food. And it says, then you harvested 1/5 of your crops will belong to the Pharaoh. Same as taxes. And you can keep the remaining 4/5 as seeds for your fields and as your food for you and your household and your people. So Joseph accepted the land, kept the land from becoming no good or desolate. He did keep it for the people. And then he said, now you can work the land, but you'll give us 1/5. And the people, they were thankful, grateful. Because they could have died. But they were grateful that Joseph had taken, accepted them as their slaves, not as bad, but as servants. Once we're saved, we're happy to be slaves for Jesus and his service, because he gave up his life for us on the cross. The resurrection is ours for eternal life once we receive salvation. He saved us from death. We were separated from God for eternity. Jesus saved us from hell. He saved us from God's judgment. And now we're happy to serve him, just like those were happy to serve Joseph and the Pharaoh. Say my name. It says, you have saved our lives, they exclaimed. May it please you, my Lord, to let us be Pharaoh's servants. Verse 26, then Joseph issued a decree still in effect in the land of Egypt. That the Pharaoh should receive 1/5 of all of the crops grown in his land. Only the land belonging to the priests was not given to the Pharaoh. All of Egypt was given to Pharaoh. Verse 27. Meanwhile, the people of Israel settled in the region of Goshen in Egypt. There they increased in their possessions. They became wealthy. They acquired property. They were fruitful. And population grew rapidly. They were fruitful. And their population, meaning the number of people, grew fast. Jacob lived there for 17 years after his arrival in Egypt. And he lived 147 years in all. So in 17 years, the Jewish people. At the time of his death drew near, Jacob called his son Joseph said to him, please do me this favor. Put your hand under my thigh. That was their culture. Put your hand under your thigh and swear to me that you will promise that you will treat me with good, no unfailing love. It was his last request. By honoring this last request. Verse 30. So when I die, please take my body out of Egypt and bury me with my ancestors. Why did he want to leave Egypt? Because God had promised that he would have land, that the descendants would have land in Canaan and Egypt. He wanted to go back to Canaan. So Joseph promised, I will do as you asked. Swear that you will do it, Jacob insisted. So Joseph gave his oath. And Jacob bowed humbly at the head of his bed. So he's close to him. Okay. So this is the last. So Jacob was looking forward to going back to Canaan. Just as we look forward to heaven. That's our Canaan, our promised land. We're just nomads here. We don't belong here. We are traveling through. Our job is to spread the gospel, to live in obedience to the Lord. And it says in Hebrews 11, 13, and 14, all these people died still believing what God had promised them. They did not receive what was promised, but they saw it all from a distance and welcomed it. And they knew that God would take them back to heaven as he took Abraham back to the promised land.
Oh, I saw it by the
word of encouragement that keeps us looking forward. Even though life may be hard, that we can still look to you and trust you and know that you will provide our needs and bless us. And bless those who want to honor you in all that we do. In Jesus' name.